Tonight we're fortunate to welcome Jim Skinner, Vice Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of McDonald's Corporation. With nearly 33,000 restaurants in 118 countries, McDonald's is the world's largest food service company. 64 million customers visit the Golden Arches every day, and the company employs nearly 1.8 million people across the globe. The company's annual revenues exceed those of Starbucks, KFC, Pizza Hut, and Taco Bell combined. Jim comes from humble beginnings, the son of an Iowa bricklayer who took a job working for McDonald's when he was 16. But less than after that for a 10-year stint in the Navy. After he was discharged, a fellow sailor encouraged him to apply for a job at McDonald's. So in 1971, Jim officially became his fourth decade career at McDonald's in the Navy of training. He rose steadily through the ranks, eventually overseeing operations in Europe and India, the Middle East and Africa. Having completed world tour of McDonald's, he returned to the domestic operations and was named the company's vice chairman, at the time one of the three top executive positions. His appointment as CEO in November 2004 followed two tragedies. First, former CEO Jim Cataluca died of a heart attack that year. Then, just 7 months on the job, Cataluca's successor, Charlie Bell, resigned to undergo paper thinning. He also unfortunately died in January 2005. On the heels of a very sad and tumultuous time for the company, Jim ushered in a true golden age for the Golden Arches. Since taking the helm as CEO in 2004, the company has delivered an annual growth rate of 5%, with revenue topping $24 billion last year. Same-store sales, a closely watched industry metric, is pointing to 7 years of its tenure, and in that time, the stock has returned more than 250% versus 16% for the S&P 500. I think we all agree that 230.4% gain over the S&P 500 is a whopper, Jim, for part of the fund. McDonald's is proud of the team's leadership because he's remained true to Great Crock's values of quality, service, cleanliness, and value. At the same time, Jim has made sure McDonald's continues to adapt to evolving customer tastes and demands. The team now entices aging and more health-conscious consumers with new menu items, caters to night hours with extended hours, and lures upscale customers with a cafe line of beverages, including smoothies and my favorite lattes. Being the world's largest food service company does not come without challenges. The 2001 bestseller Fast Food Medicine and the 2004 documentary Superstars of Me vilified McDonald's for contributing to a national obesity epidemic. Jim would argue that it would be the charge, but nonetheless, McDonald's responded, pulling the Superstars menu and healthier options like salads and edible slices. McNuggets seems to be only white meat, and nutritional information is made available. In addition, Jim has worked to redeem the company's image by promoting physical activity programs for kids and adults and sponsoring local youth sport teams. All the while, Jim has prioritized the company's framework, Plan to Win, which involves bringing the 5 points. People, products, place, price, and promotion. The company's revitalization is largely due to Jim's efforts to institute this playbook. Instead of focusing on bigger, Jim likes the bigger. The frenzy to open new stores was halted, and the company focused instead on improving current stores. Franchises were modernized and outfitted with widescreen TVs and Wi-Fi connections. He sold off the company's investment in outside brands like Chipotle, explaining that we took our eyes off the profit. Focusing on the main enterprise, having three works. A study found Ronald McDonald was nearly as recognizable as Santa Claus. The brand is powerful, and Jim makes sure everyone at McDonald's remembers they are first and foremost business. Albeit an evolving business, Jim used to favor a no frills quarter pounder that rumor used to now fans of making the business. Employees described Jim as a humble leader who empowers his staff. He created a leadership institute for high potential employees and is so dedicated to developing talent that some say it may be the greatest legacy to the company. However, those who seem to feel they're appointed for the job need not apply for benefits. Echoing the path of disappointed CEO, Jim requires all executives to bring at least two potential successors. One who could do the job completely and ready now in McDonald's speak, and one who could be a future replacement, knowing it in the future. Jim makes no exceptions for himself, although he says he has no plans for retirement. Jim has been a member of the board of directors of the Dutch Corporation since 2004. He also served on the boards of Broadway Dutch Series, the Walgreens Company, and Catalyst, and I'm pleased to have him spend a night with him in the board of directors. He has strong commitment to support the community's evidence, but his work with several civic and business organizations, including the Chicago Club, the Civic Committee of the Commercial Club of Chicago, the Economic Club of Chicago, the Executive Club of Chicago, and the Society Council of Logan Printers. Jim also serves on the board of trustees of the Winter Bayer Museum of Science and Industry. He and his wife, Kathleen, have been married for over 40 years. Please help me welcome the princess of self-made lady who redefines what means to be between the common burger cheese, common burger captain, and please help follow the home center here on the team. Jim Skinner.
Well, thank you for that warm introduction. I can see that I'm looking at the people back to the end of the speech. Looks like you might have looked at my comments, but it's true that you have quite a few things that I'm not going to talk about. But I'll have a little different twist to them. You represent it, but it's a tremendous honor and privilege for the program to be here to speak. I've been with a esteemed group of club directors and other distinguished Chicagoans. Now, this evening, this will be no surprise that Tony Strader gave him a McDonald's revitalization story. I think that David's going to talk about how we have distinguished ourselves with consumer insights and innovation. And in thinking about it, I thought, well, where will I start? Because even though I've lived this story, I've not really told it in its entirety. So I thought the best way to do that is to provide you with some background of McDonald's. In order to give you a full understanding of what kind of business we really are with, and then go from there. So, around the world, as David mentioned, nearly 33,000 restaurants in 118 countries and serving 64 million customers every day in 2010. I'm expecting that number to be bigger in 2011 as we continue to grow. Now, these are big numbers. But it's important to note that we build our business by building McDonald's one restaurant at a time, one franchise at a time, one customer at a time. I have a lot of colleagues at the other companies that are franchisees, company people, and many people think, well, that particular thing is like one being at a time. I think this is not like this, it's the way we operate. The reason why we've been able to maintain steadfast standards of execution by restaurants, one restaurant at a time, one franchise. We operate under a unique business model of all our operators, suppliers, and employees. We call this our three-legged stool. Today, we are 80% franchised around the world, 89% in the United States. If you do the math, it's very different around the world, but 80% of our restaurants are franchised. And I consider these 5,000 or so organizations. Industry has one of the best entrepreneurs. Our franchise is really what you think about it. Some of the best entrepreneurs in the world, period. The power of our franchise community is always backing larger than McDonald's. It is a tremendous competitive advantage. Our suppliers perform what I call the McDonald's Kitchen Miracle, combining all 33,000 restaurants at a certain supplier's table. leadership, it's an unparalleled advantage for McDonald's. Lastly, our enormously talented company employees and leadership team work tirelessly to protect our business forward. And it's important that I'm hearing this team work because that's what it's developed and it's dependent on the other. So the company will make 16 different franchisees as suppliers of successful increasing dairy farms and case farmers. It goes all the way down to craft dinner, from the set, from craft to the great. First, the franchisees will work. If that works, then everything else shall follow. Now, today, we're doing a good job in the system of succeeding. 2010, the global pedicle sales increased 5%, marking our 8th consecutive year in same pro sales growth. Consolidated operating income grew 30%. We continue to gain market share in every market around the world. And we're delivering 27% total shareholder return for the year, ranking us third among the companies comprising the top 30 industrial IOs, while maintaining the number one position in the 3 and 5 year measures. We continue to perform well in 2011 as our expected quarter operating income rose 11% of constant currency, and our earnings per share also grew 11%. And in August marked our 100th consecutive month of global sales growth. I know that in our industry, that's going to come right. Believe me, we're proud of it. And the time when the overall leading our industry is quite for declining for broader governance as tense. With the clinical team manager of success in this environment we're dealing with today. We've had more customers coming today than we had yesterday. That's the truth. The strength of our business and potential with the consumers. In the U.S. last year, we had our highest guest count growth in more than 20 years, and we're achieving similar growth around the world. Simply put, we're giving more customers more reasons to visit McDonald's. But it wasn't always this good. So what are you seeing? Turnaround is the storm growth that follows our life continuing in the early part of this century. When we were on the course, our sales and stock price were in decline. In early 2003, stock was an all-time low. My notes were about $12. It was actually $12.13 of the money. We were lagging behind our rivals and most customers had expansions for these. Many of our guests who were once coming in, that most were not coming back. We were too focused on getting bigger rather than getting better. Like many other companies were the view, we viewed rapid expansion as a prerequisite to continue success. We were already big, but we wanted to get bigger. So we saw all growth in new restaurants, new brands, and new lines of business. Doing so, we moved away from the essence of our brand, which was running great restaurants and serving great tasteful food under the Golden Age. We also moved away from profitability. We couldn't have a minute, I mean, to run McDonald's without talking about 4 to 5% top line growth from just a few minutes. Because we couldn't help people were talking about where's the gross margin, what about the next gross? We spent $5 million. Over a 5 year time frame from the end of 2002 and this third increase without adding a penny of operating income. Now, all of you out there know that the incentive equation for sustainability and success. And as David said, what we'd like to say now, hopefully, it's still as soon as we took that out of some of our friends. Within a company changes were made. Our board elected new CEO, Jim Cantalupo, who David mentioned. I was promoted to vice chairman. I was proud of it in 2002, so I feel very fortunate to have survived the changes. But I've worked with Jim Cantalupo. the minor leadership, the system keeps our focus on our best trade and playing the work service well strategically as a blueprint. We're not changing it. It's a neat state, of course. It's a simple business. We should be getting complete. But it's a good thing to know our next topic, which is really innovation, customer insights. Two priorities that are significant drivers of our system. During the revitalization period, we've got a renewed emphasis on execution and innovation. It's not straightforward enough, but it's not always that easy. A lot of companies are good at one without the other. They execute well with struggles to develop new ideas that customers are seeking, or they have great ideas. We can't execute them well enough to make them work. And I want to say, a mediocre strategy executed well is better than a great strategy executed poorly. With the size of McDonald's, you can understand how they can make some sense with all the moving parts that they have around the world. As McDonald's, we've always been known for execution. We build our brand on delivering a consistent expert experience with a high quality, quality service that comes to the value, which comes back from the great practice. A big part of our problem is that everyone was back then when we had this problem is that this works to replace the system work emphasis on elevating our operations and service to put a greater across the system, our customer satisfaction scores have gotten better, much better, but we still have room for improvement. Always will when you talk about the customer speak and friends. When you think about 33,000 restaurants and 118 companies and 50-some people every day coming in there at the front counter and drive to try to deliver that moment of grief, that's a lot of training and expectation. Diligence that has to be followed up on a regular basis. So the moment of truth, you know, I just call it at that point of interaction, at the front counter of the driver, you're all customers, or maybe not all of you. Most of your customers, and you know that there's been 3 million of us here in advertising. How hard would you get communicated to? And when you go to the driver's window, you go to that time of your next friend's presence, it takes the greatest break to do. None of those other things matter. So that's the execution part. You have to be able to deliver the rest of those before you can do anything else. Even if it, you can't do it, you can't execute what you got already. So the other side of the equation is innovation. We all know that in the corporate world, learning what's expected of you is not enough. You have to do more. You have to do it on a continuous basis. I mentioned that it can be a challenge for a company to get self-employed and execution and innovation, and that was what's the case for us. We knew how to execute. We had to get better at innovating and connecting with our customers for a long time. We had the mentality that if we build it, they will come. We were growing it around the world, serving more and more guests. And we just think that we really knew what was going for our customers. The problem was that this led to an innovation process that could be we were rolling out new and different things that our customers didn't always want. I'm always reminded of pizza. Everybody remember when we had personal pan pizza in my first anyway. Pizza was very successful because they were surprised with the bucket of money that they had never touched the night before because they communicated so much about how to sell anything for a short period of time. But even in the United States, we had a great pizza. Customers just were not coming to McDonald's to buy pizza, and they told us that. And so, no more pizza. Or they were going to work. Anyone remember that one? It was the vegetable-based pan that was cooling terrific. A great idea. The customers, however, hated it. What we realized is that we need to focus more on what the customers wanted instead of what we thought they needed. So the development of very robust consumer insights process of that system. Most of this happened on my watch. The more I understand the consumer needs and how McDonald's provides the business for those needs, it helps us become more strategic and thoughtful about product innovations. We have tried to apply here, popular menu assortment, such as salads, and bread, and home bacon. I don't know about you guys, but I know a lot of home bacon McDonald's. We want to step through our story this year, and another great case in high quality option on menu. Now, here's a commercial about it. Yeah, I think you should make a presentation. I'll bring a couple commercials up. So here's a commercial about both of them. Today, we still remain focused on providing more choice and variety. If we know customers continue to look to McDonald's for even more balanced options on their menu, choices that they feel good about when they visit McDonald's. The consumer-centric approach has also led us to diversify our menus around the world to become more locally relevant, right? To be sure, we serve big menu fries and McNuggets across the globe, our core menu, and they're popular in a lot of places. But we're also more focused on offering local products that our customers tell us they want, like shrimp in Japan, beer in Germany, Speer in Hawaii. That's right, now, in case you didn't know it, Hawaii has the highest Speer consumption per capita of any state. They love it. So we serve it. So there you have it. I know that's the one thing that you're going to remember from your time in Hawaii. Our local relevance is to leverage the power of our global system at the same time. It wasn't always this way. It used to be that we mainly did things from the inside out. We develop an idea here in Oakbrook and then push it out to the rest of the system with results that could be hit or miss. We eventually realized that it made more sense to encourage innovation in the market. We didn't know what was going on last time, but we kept anyway. But we were closest to customers and focused the people wanted to have that freedom with that school. We never take an approach that is more outside of our four studios, which they have four studios in engineering, to the outside of the studios in Europe, and people need to develop a global relevant product. We call this the freedom within a framework, offering our markets flexibility in many areas of the global specific market and product development and innovation. But the McDonald's framework is always consistent. Your brand must be displayed by the level standard around the world, no matter what product you choose to sell. This kind of stuff is pretty nice to consider penetrating successfully around the world. A great example is from a cabin, especially in Congress. Actually, originated in Australia. The Australians have decided that they could turn in this, especially in coffee space, and that we could differentiate ourselves with the unique combination of beef, quality, and value. And they were right. The cabin proved to be successful. And then we found a modified version of that in the United States, where it's been a major contributor to our business growth over the past 10 years. Our largest principal companies and smoothies has impacted our U.S. business like few other new platforms ever had. They've made us a beverage distribution and added millions of new customers to our fleet. Most people don't know that in the U.S. only beverages are $146 billion business. So we're lucky to keep in first Europe. And we're expanding from a gasping line in Europe and Asia. A little bit different comes from becoming a true local player in the coffee and blended ice business. Now, here's one more idea to let us into that I want to show you, which helps us launch on the cafe office. I'm other point I'd like to make about immigrants is that it should be holistic or something. It's from your entire business to not just the things that grab headlines. One of the most important areas of innovation for us is not to grow our restaurant capacity. Believe it or not, there are times where the proposals we have restaurants are stressed by the number of customers that we have. Now, a good problem to have, but it complicates the issue. I know that all of you, when you drive by, you see too many times as soon as you drive by, they don't come in. It's very important for us to be able to deliver 30 feet by hours to continue to grow our business. So we've been working on new ways to increase our capacity in order to be able to send more guests. One solution is the double drive-through. I'm sure some of you have seen those, which increases our throughput yields wide quicker. But we've also developed an entire new point-of-sale system that makes it easier for the managers and crew. We have a small new McDonald's that's not real, so there's no direct price. Extraordinarily important that we're spending our time focused on how we can make it easier for the managers and crew to deliver a guest while we're here for them time. I'm not going much, but it's going to be important to make ourselves for service times, helping us grow the business for our customers and for the service times. What's more, fun things here is it comes to our restaurant innovation programs and operations and admissions programs. You've all seen that right now, Mr. Bond, and the master growth of the bond, huge undertaking. By the time you get to the local park, that will be tough to get to the restaurant store. You know, it's a 33,000 store. Never. We're at about 40% of the 10 years now. A little further behind the next year, because we didn't quite catch the idea that we did the interior stuff to the exterior. So that people are driving by and have no idea what the interior is. We're not perfect. So we're catching up with them. So just let me summarize by saying that everything we're doing links back to our customer focus point of one. Holistic is flexible. A lot of us have done up the right priorities at the right time. What I bring it is today with this table's three global priorities and the plan to win. Downtown to the French language charge up into the two by trade notes of optimizing the menu with the right food and beverage and the operates modernizing the customer experience, upgrading every aspect of our restaurants, and broadening accessibility for continued convenience and value initiatives. In the end, you all know it's not just one initiative. You don't have the luxury of focusing on one thing. You have to bring it on McDonald's. You have to focus on everything. And we must remain committed to execution and innovation, always taking the key from the customer. They have to be one and meet your customers where they are and however they want to be more integrated with your brand. So we're continuing to explore the way you can put a longer business to keep up with our customers' changing needs. It's why you will continue to see new food and beverages that make us more relevant than ever. Self-ordering kiosks to hear it. Some of you guys, the next to many. Even ordering for testing payments in your case for the most cutting-edge speaking convenience for delivery services to the rest of Latin America, where customers want us to come to them. Many other examples, more to come. I just want to say that you can probably tell that I'm proud of the McDonald's story, but understand that I was just that fragile. You all know that I'm professor on this case for the last year and a half. So when people ask me what keeps me awake at night, I get this that most of the time when I make presentations, it's complacency. In other words, somehow, well, first time I got there, I'm not saying that they don't think that'll happen, but we'll forget. And at the first time, start to change. It's like the important state of course. We're to tell me what we're more today than yesterday and keep the guns kind of going and growing. So, David, thank you. The first one is
the success of your franchise is an internal one, and here's the franchise. These individuals are the largest small businesses and hire significant members of the team, underscoring the role of small businesses in general training job training. Lately, this has a lot of attention on the role of federal policy, enabling tech and regulatory policy, and potentially dampening the impact of small businesses. What are you hearing from your franchisees on this issue, and what do you do if you can send the most powerful revenue to create greater benefits for small businesses and make that issue to grow and invest?
Well, I'm very excited from our franchisees that I have the most small business experience. McDonald's is a federation of small businesses. And what I'm hearing from them is constraint over the uncertainty of the regulation of the legislative environment, the healthcare environment, the social environment, the business environment. And much of my business does not work for them. It's not about what will be tenders. It's about certainty about what will be tenders and what predictability around that is. And so I think most people are feeling like, look, if you're going to grow the economy, you're going to solve all the world's problems. They don't do the advantage of small business. The other thing is, we're talking about the wealthy people who are promoting $50,000 in writing speech by a small business. 60% of small business jobs are created by small businesses. And so, what I wish they had asked me, to our president, is that as the Federation of Small Businesses, it's important for us to have some stability around the business environment, understanding that this plan for small businesses is led by fair taxes and understanding that's great jobs. And this includes the health care issue. We'd like to have people have access to health care within this. There are nothing of access to health care, but it shouldn't be totally borne by the burden of the employer. And
McDonald's has been successful outright as kind of because of the U.S. discovery units, particularly in the beverage and the health flows of expansion. Of many food issues and trends in Scandinavian 50 plants, these big foods, food allergy, lactose intolerance, or increased vegetarian, and what you'll see from the majority of what do you watch the most closely before entering into your business model? Many options are different from other companies that you think might be stable professionals in the U.S.
Well, Mark, I think we pay attention to all of those things that we have personally. But what we pay most attention to are our 64 million customers today, which by the way, was 60 million in 2009, 64 million in 2010. So I believe some of my people think they are more efficient relative to what they think of their behaviors.
No matter what they
say, it's when one is the friends very closely, just like organic, for instance, the people I said, well, we just got more organic food. If people bought more organic food, just 3% of the market was. And so we can do anything we want relative to the management. We're willing to do whatever our customers want us to do. But we pay close attention to all of those things. And most important, it's about providing the choice and the value that make our customers feel good about the differences. I'm not in a position to be prescriptive to people about what they should eat. I don't think anybody else should be. We can provide choices about the customers and the services.
My brother Jameson was having a prescribing from COVID-19. They said, from a public health point of view, more people go